Hello, everybody. Welcome. My name is Simon Wright. I am the Director of Programming at Japan House London. And welcome to this event, The History of Sakai, in conversation with Simon Kaner and Sakai City Museum. This event is the first in a four-part webinar series entitled Sakai, Ancient Technology and Industrial Heritage, held in partnership with Sakai City Industrial Promotion Center, and explores the culture, history, and industry of Sakai City, Osaka Prefecture's second largest city. Before we start, let me run through some brief housekeeping rules. Please note that your microphone and webcam will be disabled for the entire duration of the event. Please use the question and answer feature to type your questions for the presenters at any time throughout the session. If you do not want your name to be attached to your question, please check the option Send Anonymously. Questions will be collected by Japan House moderators and a selection will be answered live at the end of the event. So please note that we may not be able to answer all the questions during the session, however. All the contents of this event will be streamed live on Facebook, YouTube, and LinkedIn, and a recording will be archived on those platforms later. So today's event is broadcast live from London, Norwich, and Sakai City in Osaka Prefecture. The event is chaired by Professor Simon Kaner, Executive Director of the Sainsbury Institute for the Study of Japanese Arts and Cultures, and features presentations by two special guest speakers from Sakai City Museum. Firstly, Sakai City Museum curator Tachibana Izumi explores the archaeological mystery of the Mozu Kofungun, a group of megalithic tombs in Sakai City. And then curator Shirakami Noriyuki focuses on the history and characteristics of Sakai's hand-forged knives, which the area has been known for around 600 years. And after these presentations, the speakers from Sakai City Museum are joined in conversation by Professor Kaner. And finally, there is an opportunity for speakers to answer a selection of the questions submitted by today's attendees. So please do send in your questions using the Zoom question and answer function at any time during the session. So without further ado, let me introduce Simon Kaner. Thank you very much for joining us, Simon. Thank you. For those who may not know who you are, let me give them a brief introduction. So Professor Simon Kaner is Executive Director of the Sainsbury Institute for the Study of Japanese Arts and Cultures, where he is also Head of the Center for Archaeology and Heritage and Director of the Center for Japanese Studies at the University of East Anglia. He curated the exhibition, The Power of Dogu, at the British Museum, where he is also closely involved with the Gowland Project, reassessing the Kofun period materials and archive accumulated by William Gowland, who investigated many Kofun in Osaka and elsewhere in the 19th century. His recent publications include An Illustrated Companion to Japanese Archaeology and The Archaeology of Medieval Towns, Case Studies from Japan and Europe, both available from Archaeopress of Oxford. One of his pandemic projects has been the online Jomon Matsuri. Welcome. Thank you very much, Simon, for joining us today. I would also at this juncture maybe like to also welcome Eir Kurosawa, who is joining us from now on to help with any interpretation. But without further ado, let me hand over to you, Simon. Thank you very much.
Simon, thank you very much for that very kind introduction, and a good afternoon, everybody in the UK. Good evening, everybody in Japan. How wonderful to be back in Sakai. I'm joined this afternoon by one of my heroes, William Gowland, who Simon touched on. Gowland lived in Osaka for 16 years in the 19th century, and I know spent time in Sakai, so he's definitely with us in spirit today and was fascinated by Kofun, which we're going to be hearing about very shortly. It's my very great pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Tachibana Izumi. Tachibana-san graduated with an MA from Osaka University and specializes in Haniwa, these amazing terracotta tomb figures, which are found all around the Kofun. And she's published widely on this, including in a publication celebrating Shirakami Noriyuki's 60th birthday back in 2019 on Haniwa Ronzo. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Tachibana-san, who's going to talk to us about the amazing Kofun tombs of Sakai. Tachibana-san, dozo yoroshiku onegai shimasu.
Hello everyone, my name is Izumi Tachibana. Nice to meet you. 今からは日本語でお話しさせていただきます。
Hello, I will be speaking in Japanese from now on.
今地図で見ていただいてるんですけども、堺市の場所、一番右側に書いてあります。
As you can see on this map, we have explained where Sakai City is in relation to Osaka Prefecture and Japan.
堺市にはモズ古墳群と呼ばれる古墳群があるんですけども、今日はそのお話をさせていただきます。
There is a tomb cluster called Mozu Kofungun within Sakai City, and I will be explaining about what Mozu Kofungun is.
古墳とは土を持ったお墓のことです。
Kofun is a burial mound with the mounded tomb.
日本の古墳時代は3世紀の半ばから6世紀の終わり頃、7世紀頃まで続いた時代です。
Japanese coffin period began from mid-3rd century to the end of 6th century, almost to the 7th century CE.
この時代、日本の一番北の方と南の方と除いてなんですけども、日本全国で古墳が作られます。
Apart from the northern and southern tips of Japan, there were many coffins built in this period in Japan.
古墳時代より前の時代はそれぞれ地域でバラバラだったんですけども、ちょうどこの頃、古墳を通じて日本が一つにまとまりかける時期というふうに言われています。
Previous to coffin periods, all the cultures and tribes were completely separate to each other, but, The coffin period united, almost started to unite Japan as one nation.
そうですね。国として成立するような時期と言えるかもしれません。
Yes, you could say that it was beginning to have a history as one nation from then.
その中で、モズ古墳群は5世紀に作られた古墳群です。
So bearing that in mind, モズ古墳群 was built in the 5th century CE.
当時の大王のお墓と考えられる大きなお墓を含みます。
We consider that Mozu Kofungun includes some of the large scale tombs, which is considered to be the burial mound for the emperors.
今44基が残っていますけども、5世紀には100基以上の古墳が作られたと考えられています。
There are 44 tombs and coffins left in theTomb clusters, but in the 5th century, there were more than hundreds. We believe that there were more.
Mozu Kofungun と古市古墳群の空から見た写真です。
This is the aerial shot of the Mozu Kofungun and 古市古墳群。
2019年に Mozu 古市古墳群が世界遺産に登録されました。
In 2019, both Mozu Kofungun and 古市古墳群 were registered as the World Heritage Site.
なぜ登録されたかと言いますと、まず一つ目、古墳時代の社会構造を示すものであること。
The reason that it was registered was because that first, it shows the social structure of the coffin period.
古墳というものが立体的な、土星の建造物、すごく巨大なものも小さいものも含まれる土星の建造物であること。
Because the coffins show the structural how the burial mound was structured in such a way.
ハニワ、これは土物焼き物ですけども、そういうものを立てて飾ったりする独特な葬送儀礼があること。
And it came with the original ceremonial styles and celebrations, with including figures such as Haniwa terracotta figures.
これらのことから世界遺産に登録されています。
Those factors were important in these kofunguns being registered.
実は古墳には様々な形のものがあります。
There are many shapes of coffins, as you can see here.
モズ古墳群にはこの上の4つの形があります。
モズ古墳群 includes these four top four shaped coffins.
前方後円墳。
前方後円墳。Which is the keyhole-shaped burial mound.、は
い、とホタテ貝型墳。
Second is a scallop shell-shaped burial mound. And round one.
方墳。
And square burial mound.
他の地域の古墳にはその下の様々な形のお墓があることが分かっています。
And we know that there are other shaped coffins、listed on the bottom of the list, I mean, within other coffin clusters.
モズコ墳群が作られた場所ですけども、この上の部分が海、昔の海になります。
And where Mozuko Fungun, the tomb clusters is built, is you can see on the top of top left of the map that there is sea, there was sea in the ancient times.
そこからそんなに遠くない大地の上に作られました。
And it's not that far from the coastline, if you look on the map. So it was built on the plateau, pretty near the sea.
当時、海から見たときにとても巨大な構造物、人工で作ったものが見えて人々を驚かせたと思います。
I believe that it must have been surprising, coming from the sea to find these giant tombs and tomb clusters, which were built by men.
それではいくつかモズコ墳群の主要な古墳を紹介したいと思います。
I will introduce you to some of the main, coffins within the Mozu.Coffin-gun tomb cluster.
一つ目が仁徳天皇陵古墳です。
First is 仁徳天皇陵古墳。
これは墳丘の大きさが486メートルもあるとても大きなお墓です。
The length of the coffin itself is 486 meters, so it is a very large-scale tomb.
日本でも一番大きなもので、世界を見てもかなり大きな規模であることがわかります。
It is the largest in Japan, and even compared against other tombs, in the world, it is still, considered very big.
古墳の周りに小さな古墳がたくさんありますけども、これは大きな古墳と関係のする古墳、お墓だというふうに考えられています。
And you can see on the map that there are smaller scale coffins around this Nintoku Tennoryo coffin, and we believe that they are the tombs for the ones related to, this particular emperor.
写真で見るとこのような感じですね。
And this is, these are the pictures.
左側のものが、地上から見た、地上の、地上から見たものです。
And one on the left is shot from the ground.
右側のものが上から空から見た写真ですね。
And one on the right is the aerial shot.
今は木が生い茂ってますけども、昔は石が張られていて、埴輪が並んでいるという光景だったと考えられています。
Now you see the trees lined up on top of the coffins, but, in the ancient times, it would be just bare mound, with the 埴輪 figures lined up.
仁徳天皇陵古墳の中には、石の棺と石の部屋がありました。
Within the 仁徳天皇陵coffin, there was a stone chamber and coffin.
石の部屋の中には、金銅製の甲冑やガラスの器があったと言われています。
Within the stone chamber, we believe that there was gilt bronze, items such as gilt bronze armor and glass containers, which were buried at the same time.
どちらもとても珍しいものです。
And these, both items exhibited are extremely rare.
次に、イタスケ古墳に進みたいと思います。
Next, I'd like to introduce you to イタスケ古墳。
イタスケ古墳はモズコ墳群の中で8番目の大きさの古墳です。
イタスケ古墳 is the eighth largest within the モズ古墳群。
この古墳は、昭和30年に市民運動によって守られた古墳です。
And this tomb, coffin was protected, with the civil safeguarding campaign, which was done in the Showa 30th year, which was in the 60s.
このあのイタスケ古墳の保存運動が日本の国内での遺跡を守る運動の始めだというふうに言われています。
This campaign is considered important because it was the first citizen-led safeguarding campaign within Japan to protect, ancient, sites.
これがその時に使われたチラシです。
And this is the leaflet that was used back then.
私たち郷土の誇り、イタスキ古墳を守りましょうというふうに書かれています。
It shows that let's protect the, our prefectural pride, イタスキ古墳。
1955年に、市民や若手の考古学者が保存運動をしました。
And this campaign started in 1955, led by the local, citizens and academics.
そのためにこの古墳は今でも守られています。
And that is why this coffin is, safely protected, by the citizens.
最後に大塚山古墳を紹介します。
Lastly, I will introduce you to 大塚山古墳。
この古墳は残念ながらもう、削られてしまって今はない古墳です。
And this coffin sadly does not, exist anymore, because it has been destroyed.
ただ、残っていればモズ古墳群で5番目の大きさというとても大きな古墳でした。
If it had not been destroyed, it would have been the fifth largest within the Mozu Kofungun, so it was a large scale tomb.
この古墳からは鉄でできた製品というのがたくさん見つかっています。
Within Otsukayama Coffin, there have been many iron products, were excavated from the site.
このような鉄っていうものが、これからの次の話にも出てくると思います。
I believe that these importance of irons and iron made, products will be explained in the next explanation.
簡単でしたけども、モズ古墳群の紹介を終わります。
It was brief, but thank you for listening about Mozu Kofungun.
Thank you so much, Tachibana-san. What wonderful sites you've got in Sakai City, and I think we're all very envious of you to be able to work on these things. But thank you for that very nice introduction. Our next speaker is Shirakami Noriyuki. Shirakami-san graduated from Kansai University and joined the Sakai City Hall back in 1983. And since then, he's been researching the history of Sakai City, at the Sakai City Museum, which is where I believe you're joining us from this evening. So I think it means that we could not ask for a more highly qualified specialist, to talk to us, on the iron industry and the knives that are produced, in Sakai. So, Shirakami-san, it's over to you. Dozo yoroshiku onegai shimasu.
Sakai 市博物館の Shirakami です。今から Sakai の刃物の歴史について、お話をしたいと思います。
Hello, nice to meet you. My name is Shirakami from Sakai City Museum. I will be talking about the history of blaze making, in the Sakai City.
Sakai の刃物の歴史といいましても、実は古い時代のことはあまりよく分かっていません。
I said I will be talking about the history, but unfortunately, we don't have very clear information about what has happened in the ancient times.
分かっていないんですけれども、その堺の刃物の始まりと考えられるのが、先ほどご紹介させていただいた古墳に、見ることができます。
Although it's not clear, the origin of blaze making, we believe that it dates back to the coffin period, which Tachibana-san explained just now.
今写真に出ておりますのが、大塚山古墳の出土品であります。
What you can see in these pictures are what was excavated from the 大塚山古墳 site.
そこにですね、剣が見えています。
You can see the sword.
それから、矢尻のようなものであったり、あるいはちょっと槍ガンナですかね、あのみですか、あの大工道具のようなもの、これも刃物であります。
And also you can see things which resemble arrowheads and also some carpenter tools.
これらの刃物は 展示されているものはわずかでありまして、実際にはこれのそうですね、まあ、何十倍という量が見つかっています。
All those exhibited are only a limited number of the excavated items. We believe that there are ten times more of these items.
堺の古墳にたくさんの刃物が収められているこの事実。
The fact that these edged tools were buried with the coffins, alongside coffins in coffins, is just is very evident.
堺周辺でたくさんの刃物が作られていたとしてもおかしくないですね。
So it's natural for us to think that these edged tools were made in and around Sakai City.
この後、歴史上刃物のことが出てきますのが、およそ13世紀の頃であります。
And after the coffin period, we do find evidence of edged tools being mentioned in the 13th century CE.
堺で作られた鋳物製品を売り歩く人たちが火事で作ったすきとかくわ、これは畑を耕す道具でありますけれども、火事で作った、まあ、刃のあるものですね。こういったものがあるということが13世紀の資料に見えます。
At the time, there were some agricultural items that had been sold in Sakai, but to farm those produce, there were some evidence of farming equipment such as spade and hoe being made in Sakai, and they were cast in the city.
これも決定的な証拠はないんですけれども、状況的には堺の近くで作ったと考えていいと思います。
There isn't a clear-cut evidence that they were definitely made in Sakai City, but evidently it seems very likely that they were all made very in Sakai City and nearby.
次に出てくる資料は15世紀、16世紀の頃であります。
And the next evidence comes from the 15th and 16th century CE.
これは皆さんご存知の方いらっしゃるかもしれませんが、日本刀であります。
And some of you might be familiar with these items. They are Japanese swords.
日本刀には作った人の名前であったり、作った土地であったり、それから作った年代を記録しているものがあります。
Some of Japanese swords show information such as the caster, the place it was made, and also the period that it was made.
堺あるいはその近くで作られた15世紀、16世紀の日本刀が知られています。
And so,There are many well-known Japanese swords which was made in Sakai in the 15th and 16th century CE.
また、この頃、日本は中国の明と貿易をしていました。
And around this time, Japan had a trade relationship with the Ming Dynasty in China.
日本から明への輸出品の主要なものの中に多くの日本刀が含まれていました。
And a lot of what Japan exported at the time to the Ming was Japanese swords.
この明との貿易の後半には、堺の港から船が出て、堺の港に帰ってくるという状況でした。
And these trades began.From the port of Sakai and then returned to that exact port.
輸出したその1回に輸出した数としては1万を超える数の日本刀が含まれている場合もありました。
In some cases, one ship contained more than 10,000 Japanese swords in just one trade trip.
当時日本は内戦の状態、戦国時代と呼んでいますけれども、日本でも日本刀はかなり必要とされていたわけです。
At the time, Japan is in the Sengoku period, which is considered to be the civil war, period of Japan.
そういったことを考えますと、おそらく堺の近くでたくさんの刀が作られてい、ても不思議ではありません。
Bearing this in mind, it wouldn't be so strange for the Sakai city to be the hub of Japanese sword making.
また、16世紀の前半の段階におきまして、日本に火縄銃、鉄砲が伝来します。
In early 16th century, firearms, these guns, arrive in Japan.
その当時日本は内乱の時代ですから、新しい性能のいい武器というのは瞬く間に、広がっていくんですが、その火縄銃を作ったのも堺商人がたくさん作ったというふうに言われています。
And as I mentioned, Japan was going through the civil wars, many of them, at the time. Therefore, these newThese new items were received very well, by the feudal lords, they were used in the battles. But it has been noted that these were made in Sakai. A lot of merchants specialized in creating these guns in Sakai city.
17世紀以降は資料がかなり増えて、文字の資料もたくさん残っています。
There are many written evidence, from the 17th century onwards.
17世紀の初めの資料には、堺の特産品としていろんな種類の包丁が挙げられています。
That record written from in the early 17th century shows that, one of the notable, products made in Sakai is kitchen knife.
17世紀の後半から18世紀の初めぐらいの資料に書かれています堺の鍛冶の職人が作っていた品物ですけれども、いくつかご紹介したいと思います。
And the records that we have found from the late 17th century to early 18th century shows many items that were made by blacksmith based in Sakai city, and I'll be introducing some of them to you.
台所で使う出刃包丁を作っている鍛冶屋が20軒。
So there were 20 kitchen knife blacksmiths.
それからタバコの葉を刻む包丁を作っている鍛冶が23軒。
There were also tobacco knife blacksmiths. There were 23 of them.
それから農具の桑を作る鍛冶が31件。
And also there were a hoe blacksmith, there were 31 of them.
鉄砲の鍛冶は54件。
54 firearm blacksmith.
それから19世紀の資料を見ますと、堺で作られる農具の桑はとても優れているということが書かれています。
And what we found from the 19th century mentions how exceptional, the hoe, made in Sakai city.
1868年に日本は近代となり、新しい国に生まれ変わります。
Japan begins its modern period in 1868, and it rejuvenated itself.
堺の包丁は引き続いて作られましたけれども、火縄銃は不要なものになっていきます。
And kitchen knives, continued its production in Sakai city. However, firearms production, ended, in that period.
鉄砲を作っていた鍛冶はその後、 土を掘るシャベルであったり、自転車の部品であったり、運動器具であったり、そういったものを作っていきます。
And those who needed to change their specialty from firearm and blacksmith began making the items such as spades, bicycle parts, and also those parts used in automobiles.
堺の火事の歴史を見ながら刃物のことを見ていきましたけれども、その中心はやはりずっと刃物が堺で作られ続けていたということがわかります。
I have briefly explained the history of Sakai and how blades making come into it, but you can see that how relevant it has been throughout history.
堺でどうして刃物が作られたのかっていうのは謎が多いですけれども、堺の土地柄、港があって交通の要衝であったというこういうところが大きいのかなと思います。
There are many mysteries when it comes to blaze making in Sakai. However, I believe the geographical location must have played its role. There was a major port in Sakai, and also it was a transport hub within the country as well.
その伝統は今も堺で刃物作りが行われているということに受け継がれています。
I believe the history and tradition is being passed on to the present day Sakai City blaze making.
以上で終わります。ありがとうございました。
Thank you very much for listening.
Shirakami-san, thank you for a fascinating overview of that.What an amazing industry you've had in Sakai since ancient times right through to today. We now have about 10 minutes when Shirakami-san and Tachibana-san have kindly agreed to engage with me in a little bit of discussion about what they've been talking about. So I just had a couple of observations that I would like to make. And then after that, we're going to open up for some questions from our audience.And we do invite you to put your questions into the Q&A feature of Zoom, and we'll be able to select some of those. And feel free to ask the questions in English. I believe the answers will be in Japanese, but they'll be beautifully translated for us by our translator, I think. So if I may go back to Tachibana's talk to begin with,I just have a couple of observations, really. First of all, I wanted to draw everybody's attention to the fact that here we've got William Gowland just behind me, possibly in one of the Osaka tombs, a photograph that he took himself back in the 19th century. Thanks to Gowland, here in the UK, in London, in the British Museum, in the Mitsubishi Corporation Japanese Galleries,we have what I think is probably the best collection of archaeological material from the Japanese Kofun period outside Japan. And that's because while Gowland was working at the Osaka Mint as one of their chief engineers, his hobby became archaeology, and he investigated over 400 of these mounded tombs while he was in Japan and brought backa very considerable collection, which is now all on display. So if you do have the chance, do go and have a look in those British Museum galleries, and you can see some of this material firsthand. And there is armor and swords, as well as one of the coffins of the sort that we saw in the presentation there. But one of the things that many people say to me, as a question for Tachibana-san really, is if these are some of the largest tombs from the ancient world, possibly even bigger than the pyramids, bigger than the tomb of the first emperor of China that many of us are familiar with, why don't we know more about these tombs outside Japan already?
そうですね、今なぜは難しいですけども、人類学的にもとても面白いお墓だというふうに思っています。
Yes, it's difficult to say why it's not as well known as it should be, but anthropologically, I believe they are very interesting tombs.
日本の古代史も含めて世界中の方にぜひ知っていただきたいなというふうに思っています。
As well as Japanese archaeology, I'd love many more people to know more about these coffins.
魅力の発信は課題ですので、またいろいろ教えていただければと思います。
Yes, it's one of our tasks to let non-Japanese people know more about these appeals of these coffins. So yes, if we could work together alongside Simon-san, that would be great.
That's wonderful. And many, many congratulations on the World Heritage inscription in 2019. I don't know how many of our audience are familiar with this, but I know that it takes many, many years, maybe well over 10 years,to get a World Heritage Site inscribed by UNESCO. So I'm sure that the Sakai City Museum was closely involved in that initiative. Can I ask you, what does the impact of the World Heritage inscription going to be for the city of Sakai? And in particular, how are local people going to be encouraged to engage with these sites? And I was particularly interested that you mentioned thatOne of the sites was preserved through a citizen action movement many years ago.
はい、世界遺産になって古墳が多くの方に知っていただけたということはすごくいいことだというふうに思っています。
Yes, I believe it was definitely a positive thing that many people learnt and knew about these coffins by them being registered as the UNESCO World Heritage Site.
古墳や文化財が大事だというふうに思ってもらえることで古墳の保存につながるのではないかというふうに考えています。
I believe people are acknowledging that coffins and these cultural excavated items are valuable and that would lead to the protection, future protection of these sites as well.
そして今、堺市民の方々は、例えば古墳の周りの清掃活動をしたり、
And these citizens in Sakai are very proactive. They do clean, they lead their cleaning activities within their coffin sites.
あと地域で興味を持った方々が古墳についての勉強会を始めたり、
And those who began interested in coffins, they lead study groups amongst themselves.
あとは、うちの堺市博物館での展示も行っています。
And they come and see our exhibitions in the Sakai City Museum as well.
Well, that's wonderful. And I know my understanding is that many of these sites are actually in the guardianship of the Imperial Household Agency, which makes it difficult forordinary people to actually visit the site, to go onto the sites. But I know it is possible to see them from a little bit of a distance. And it's great that you have good exhibits in the Sakai City Museum as well. Indeed, just a couple of years ago, I was able to climb up. There's an observatory on top of the Sakai City Hall, I think. And I was able to climb up there with a couple of colleagues of mine and enjoy the view out over the Kofun. Best seen from above in many ways.But I think it'd be really great to have a good illustrated introduction to these sites in English. And I wondered if this is something that Sakai City would be interested in such a project.
そうですね。ぜひなかなか日本語だと知ってもらえないことも多いので、ぜひ英語で世界に向けて発信したいと思います。
Yes, exactly. We would be very much interested in getting more information out in English, so it would be more accessible to the wider audience.
That would be wonderful. It might make a really nice project for the 100th anniversary of William Cowland's death back in 1922. I'd now like to come on to Shirakami-san's really fascinating presentation and ask a little bit about knives and ironworking in Sakai. And I'd like to suggest start by thinking about, I know that many people here are very interested in the samurai of later Japanese history and their armor. For example, I know that the armor which is on display in the Japanese galleries at the British Museum is one of the most popular attractions for people to come and see there. Could you say, obviously the samurai armor is medieval, maybe a little bit later. Are there connections between the samurai tradition of armor and the earlier armor that we saw, the Kofun period armor that we saw?
それは関係があると思います。古墳時代に甲冑があって、それが形を変えながら日本人にあった、あるいはその戦の戦いのやり方にあったような形に改良されていって、まあ、中世の、まあ、甲冑につながっていっていると考えていいと思います。
Yes, I believe there is a strong connection from what we saw in the Kofun period, ancient period. What we saw there would have been redesigned to fit better onto the Japanese people, Japanese warriors, but also to fit onto the purpose of these battles that they were fighting as well. So yes, you mentioned the samurai armors from the medieval times onwards, but I believe there is a strong link and connections in the evolution between the two.
That's great, thank you. You mentioned there's so many iron foundries, so many different types of blacksmiths who are active in Sakai. Can you say a little bit about how the iron industry was organized traditionally in Sakai? In the UK, we have this thing called British Steel. So all of those, the iron producers, the steel producers work very closely together. But how is it in Sakai? Was there some kind of overarching organization, or has it always been a lot of small private foundries working independently?
はい、堺の刃物の鍛冶屋さんはですね、まあ、規模が小さい、ところが多いですけれども、今お話にあったそういう同業の組合ですね、そういった形での活動というのはありますし、これは江戸時代に遡っていっても、そういう人たちが組合とは言わずに仲間と呼ぶんですけれども、そういう団体はございました。
Yes, there were collaborations between different blacksmiths, and they were a very small private blacksmith, which operated by themselves. However, these foundries worked together. So there was, in effect, they acted like a commission between themselves. However, they never called themselves that. Yes, in effect, they were working strongly together.
Well, that's very interesting. Thank you. I know that a very famous resident of Sakai in the early modern period was the famous tea master called Sen no Rikyu. And some of our listeners may be familiar with his name. And I believe he was also connected to the arms trade in some way. And I wondered, did he also have connections to the iron industry in Sakai?
はい、千の利休は1522年に堺で生まれた人です。戦国時代に生まれた人です。
Yes, so 千の利休 was born in 1522. So he was born in the middle of the Sengoku battle period in Japan.
千の利休は堺の商人でした。何を商売していたかという点については、トトウヤ、魚屋と書いてトトウヤと読みますが、そういうトトウヤであったということが言われています。
千利休 was a merchant in Sakai, and what he traded in was fish. His trade was called トトウヤ, and it was written as the fishmonger.
主に魚あるいは魚の干物ですね、そういったものを扱っていたんだろうと思いますが、 おそらく高く経営でいろんなことはやってたと想像されます。
Because of the name of his business, we believe that he must have traded in fish or dried fish of some sort. But we believe that he must have, it must have been a multifaceted business.
日本の歴史のドラマの中で千利休が出てくるシーンでですね、火縄銃を商売しているというシーンが使われたことがあります。
There was a period drama made about Senno Rikyu, and within the scene, they portrayed him trading in like firearms.
しかしながら、火縄銃を扱ったと断定できる資料はありません。
However, there isn't any record of him definitely dealing in firearms.
一つ面白い資料があります。
There is an interesting information that I can provide.
織田信長という人が戦をしていたときに、千利休が鉄砲の弾を千送って、それのお礼状を信長からもらっています。
The battle led by 織田信長, one of the feudal lords, there is a record of 千利休 sending more than 1,000 bullets to.Him and Nobunaga has written sent a letter thanking him for his effort.
これを見て、もしかしたら武器全般を飽きなっていてもおかしくないなと思う方もいらっしゃるでしょうね。
I believe there are many who would believe that he must have dealt in many different varieties of firearms based on this just one record.
Shira Kami-san, thank you so much. That's really interesting. And I think you're just demonstrates the great depth of knowledge that you have of all of those historical sources that we have for Sakai. And you've really cleared that up for me. So thank you. I could be asking questions all day, but I know that our audience have put some questions in the Q&A. I'm just going to open these up now.I'm going to pick through some of these. There's some in Japanese, some in English. We have one from Reiko K, who asks, are there iron sources close to Sakai? It's a really important question, obviously. But are there iron sources close to Sakai?Which would partly explain why the industry flourished there so much.
はい、日本の鉄の産地で、有名なのが堺から東に、300キロぐらい離れたところ。中国地方という町方があります。県で言いましたら、広島県、岡山県の、内陸ですね、山あいのところ、あの辺りで砂鉄が取れておりまして、それはおそらく6世紀ぐらいからは取れてたと思います。
Yes, there are.There is an evidence of iron being found not too far from Sakai. So about 300 kilometers to the west of Sakai, in what we know as Hiroshima and Okayama in the present day terms. So these are Chugoku section of Japan. And within the mountains of Hiroshima and Okayama site, so in inlands of these prefectures,There are some powdered irons found, and there is a record of them being found in the 6th century.
Sakai とは瀬戸内海と呼んでいる海でつながっていまして、堺に港がありますから、おそらく船で運ばれてきたんだと思います。
And these areas are connected with the inland sea called Seto Naikai, and we believe that the irons must have been transported by ship to Sakai port.
That's wonderful. Thank you very much. And It relates to another question here by an anonymous attendee who asks about whether the iron was from local ores or iron sands, and we now know that it was iron sands. But the second part of their question is about to what extent was iron reworked or recycled in the iron industry? And I wondered if Shirakami-san could say a little bit about that.
なかなかリサイクルに関する資料っていうのは見たことがありませんが、日本は資源が少ない国ですので、早くからそういうリサイクルということは考えていたというふうに思います。壊れた鉄製品が発掘で出てくるというようなことが非常に少ないので、やはり再利用していってる。再資源化をしていっているということは十分あったと思います。
There isn't any written evidence on whether these materials, iron, being recycled. However, I believe that it was very likely that it was done in such way because Japan has very limited resources, natural resources. So it must have been reused from the ancient times.One of the reasons that I can give is these excavated items, there aren't many broken iron products. Things always tend to be quite intact. So I believe that it must have been reused in some ways again.
That's wonderful. Thank you. There's an early question came in from, I think, somebody who's watching on YouTube who says, to what extent should the Kofun period be seen as the Iron Age of Japan?And perhaps we could rethink that a little bit to say, if there wasn't iron, would there have been those huge tombs built?
そうですね。鉄自体は古墳時代の前の時代に日本にやってきました。
Yes, well, iron arrived in Japan prior to the Kofun period.
ただしこの古墳っていうものを作るときには鉄っていうものがとてもたくさん必要だったと思います。例えばクワとかスキとかですね、そういうものが必要だったんだろうと思います。
But I do believe that iron must have been necessary to build these large-scale tombs, coffins, because in order to dig holes and bury the mounds, you would need items such as spade and hoe.
特に5世紀の古墳の中からはとてもたくさんの鉄が見つかります。それは前の時代と比べ物にならないぐらいたくさんです。
And the coffins built from the 5th century onwards, there are many items, equipments made with iron. And this is in comparison to the century before.
先ほどのリサイクルの話ではないですけども、この頃古墳に鉄を入れてしまうということは、もうそれ以降使えなくなってしまうということですね。
And this relates to the previous question of whether the iron, whether iron was recycled in some ways. But by burying these equipments, you wouldn't be able to recycle them in any way.
古墳に入れる以上の鉄がこの時代、日本列島に流通していたのではないでしょうか。
So, but that is another proof that there must have been enough iron to...To have, they were available all over Japan to be used for these items and to be buried in coffin.
それらの鉄を使って巨大な古墳ができたというふうに考えられます。
So yes, these iron were necessary and used to create these large-scale tombs.
That's brilliant. Thank you. We have a question from Natsue Hayward, probably for Shirakami-san.And Natsue says, I understand that the Meiji government needed a lot of firearms too, but why did Sakai stop firearm production? Were Sakai's guns too old-fashioned for modern style battles, or did Japan start to import firearms from abroad?
Meiji 時代になる時の、国内の戦争がありましたけれども、その時にもうすでに火縄銃は旧式、古い銃ということでした。
Yes, there were some civil wars in the Meiji era too. However, these firearms created in Sakai were already old-fashioned in that period.
それから、陸軍というか軍隊が作られますが、軍隊で使う武器っていうのは統一されたもので、作られていきますが、そこには当然火縄銃は採用されていません。
And also, Japanese army back then needed some firearms as well. But and these firearms made in the Sakai city weren't part of the United models that it was deployed in the Japanese army.
近代国家になってから数十年の間、堺では火縄銃は作られてはいましたけれども、数が激減し、あるいは火縄銃をもとにして農作物を荒らしに来る獣や鳥を追い払うための音だけですね、脅しずつと呼んでいますが、そういったものを作ったり、あるいは山で獣を取る猟師が使う銃としては火縄銃は少し残っていたようです。
There were some records of production being carried on from the beginning of modern times, modern periods in Japan, a few decades after. But most of them that were made were just the firearm. It wasn't a firearm as we know. It just created the sounds to ward off some of the animals and wildlife in the mountains. And they were sometimes used by hunters in the mountains as well. But yes, but those are the record that I have.
That's brilliant. Thank you very much. We have another question here. This one is about haniwa, which we know, of course, is Tachibana-san's speciality. Maybe, Tachibana-san, could you tell us a little bit more about the haniwa and where were they arranged in the kofun, and are any depicted carrying blades?
ハニワは古墳の墳丘の上や古墳の周りの包みの上に建てられていました。
Yes, so haniwas were displayed on top of the mounds or around the round part of the coffin.
ハンモノのハニワですけども、例えば、刀の形をした、飾られた刀の形をしたハニワがあります。
So in relation to the blades and haniwas,Yes, and there are some haniwas which have been displayed with the sword or the haniwas shaped with the sword.
例えば人物ハニワ、人の形のハニワに武器がついているものっていうものはあります。
And there were some haniwas, man-shaped haniwas with the sword attached to him.
That's wonderful, thank you.Two other questions about the kofun. One is, how do we know how old the kofun are? How are they dated? And how reliable are these methods thought to be?
とても難しい質問です。
Very difficult question.
ただ今でも論争があって、3世紀の半ばからという人もいれば、それより古いという人もいています。
There are some debates still going on to the present day. Some people argue that the coffin must date back from the mid-3rd century to the 6th century. So it hasn't been completely determined yet.
おそらくその頃に日本の中で大きなお墓を作るという、風習みたいなのができてきていったのではないかというふうに思います。
But we believe the tradition has begun around that time to create a large-scale tomb.
Oh, that's great. I appreciate how difficult the question about dating some of these tombs is. And if we had another couple of hours, we could really dip into some interesting things on that theme, I think. But for the time being, perhaps, Tachibana-san, you can suggest for us,where when we're able to come visit Japan again, are there any kofun where we can go and visit them and actually get inside and see what they look like inside?
そうですね。実は堺市 にあるモズコフン群は、古墳の中には入りにくい古墳なんですね。
Yes, to tell you the truth, Mozu Kofun Gun isn't the best one to go into the inside of the coffins. It's not widely available.
もう少し新しい時代、新しい時期の古墳だと中に入れるものがあります。
There are some coffins built in the newer periods which you could enter inside.
例えば奈良県の石舞台古墳などは中に入れる有名な古墳だと思います。
For example, 石舞台古墳 in Nara Prefecture is one of the notable coffins that you can go inside.
また堺と一緒に来てもらえたらいいかなと思います。
So, if the audience could come and visit both Sakai City and Nara Kofun, Ita's Kofun, that would be great.
Brilliant. Thank you very much indeed. I'm aware that we've arrived at 1 o'clock and our host has appeared back on the screen. So I'm now going to thank our two speakers very much for answering those questions as well as two amazing presentations and hand back to Simon Wright. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Simon Kaner. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. What a superb introduction to Sakai and the rich history. I look forward very much to be able to visit when we can to see these wonders in Sakai. And I hope it won't be too long, to be honest. Fingers crossed. And hopefully we will be able to see people in Sakai.In the not too distant future. Thank you very much, Professor Kaner. Thank you so much for chairing today's event. But of course, thank you very much to Tachibana Izumi, thank you, in Sakai City, and to Shirakami Noriyuki. Thank you so much. Very, very, very interesting. And it opens up the wealth of heritage that exists in this part of Osaka Prefecture.Thank you also to Air Kurosawa for interpreting. Well done. Thank you very much indeed for your help there. Thank you to the audience. Thank you for everybody who's been watching. And if you've taken part via Zoom, you'll be sent a follow-up questionnaire, which we ask you to fill in, which will help us to continue doing these events in the future. Before we disappear, and before anybody disappears, I'd just like to go through what we have coming up. We do, of course, have the next online event,with Sakai Forged Knives workshop visit and conversation. This is the second in the online event series where we pay a visit to the Forged Knives workshop and meet the master craft people who make these blades in Sakai City today. We also have an exhibition, of course, at Japan House, which will continue until the 7th of November. That's Tokyo 1964 Designing Tomorrow, looking at the design project of the 1964 Olympic Games. We also have a series of gallery tours for those who would like to have a tour of the exhibition and have a look at it in more depth. They will also run until the 7th of November. Please look at the website for details.On Saturday, the 11th of September, we have a Kamishibai storytelling group of sessions by 1,000 Cranes. This is the subject, The Great Race, which is the story of how the zodiac used in Japan has the order of the animals that it does. We also have our exhibition at Japan House on all three floors by Tokoro Asao. This is Connect, Individual and Group.Tokoro Asao, of course, is the designer of the emblems of Tokyo 2020 Olympic and Paralympic Games. And we also have on the 18th and 19th of September, a series of workshops of Orizuru Origami, that is the folded cranes, folded from paper, using the origami paper specially designed by Tokoro Asao himself.Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you once again, Simon Kaner. Thank you very much, our friends in Sakai, to Tachibana Izumi and to Shirakami Noriyuki. And we look forward to meeting everybody again in the not too distant future, hopefully. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Take care. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.